Yeah, hi, Randy. Good morning. Hi,
Good morning.
Boy, it's just, this is such a sad day. You know, I just was just thinking so many thoughts of Chet. All of us worked with him for so many years, and I keep thinking back to when Walter Cronkite was voted the most respected man in America. And I can say absolutely without any hesitation that Chet Curtis was the most respected man in New England. He was of that ilk and that stature with Walter Cronkite. He was honest, he was fair, and he just did things the right way. He wrote the blueprint. He was the voice of reason in unreasonable times. He was the one who was calm in calamitous times. And when on the set, when everything was haywire as it can be in a news department, when tapes get stuffed in the machine and a live shot goes down and all around him are losing their cool, Chet was the calm one who just stood in front of the camera and just delivered the story, and everybody believed him. He had credibility, he had likability, he had respectability.
And Mike, you know, the one thing that I was thinking about too, I mean, how many times did we anchor, you know, the 6 and the 11 o'clock news back in the days when those were the only two newscasts at night? And how many times would we actually discuss the story and debate the story and talk about the details? But Mike, do you ever remember having an actual argument with Chet? Because
no.
I don't.
I sat elbow to elbow with him. Well, it was from 82 to 2001, so almost 20 years. And those days we had a four-person anchor desk. And I was, you know, if you're looking at it, I was on the left, and there was Chet, and it was Nat, and it was Dickie. And he had a great sense of humor, and there would always be a commercial break between weather and sports. And he'd say to Bruce Goldman, how much time do we go back? And Bruce would say, 2 minutes, minute 30. And Chet would wait until about 45 seconds to go, and he would tell me a joke. And then Bruce is counting down 10, 9, 8, he'd deliver the punchline at 5 seconds. And I'd be, like, on my side laughing. And, of course, Chet would be off camera, and then we'd come up and we'd get into the sports, and he would, like, say, okay, let's say how you handle this one, rookie. I'd be telling you a joke. And he was unbelievable. I'm sure you've talked about him singing, but his sense of humor, and he always had a joke. And the other thing I remember, you know, as we probably talked about, his nickname was the mayor. And he earned that nickname, because he knew the name of every employee in the station. And every employee in the station was as important to him. They all had equal stature. He used, remember the dinners they used to host at Chet and Nat at Joe Tetchy's before Christmas?
Yeah.
And every employee in the station was invited. The courier, the mailroom people, the technicians, the writers, the photographers, the anchors, the reporters. And it was all paid for by Chet and Nat. And Chet walked around, he gave a speech, and you could have all your, it was just, let's all get together and be thankful for what we have, and that's how he showed his appreciation. But, you know, he made interns. He'd sit down and have a conversation with an intern and spend as much time with him or her as he would with the rest of the anchors or the reporters. That's who he was.
He was definitely a role model for so many of us, Mike, and we were talking before. You know, you bring up an excellent point about how he knew the names of all the employees and their children.
Sure.
And the important dates in their lives, you know. And I want to reiterate something that we said a little earlier, Mike, is that Chet had his priorities straight, always.
Mm-hmm.
If he was the guy who people recognized on the street, he was very quick to be appreciative of all the people who really made it happen, all the people behind the scenes, like you just alluded to. You know,
mm-hmm.
all the photographers and the crew and the floor directors and all the people who he really gave the credit to, and demonstratively, not just with great thank yous, which always, you know, you just always knew if you were involved in something Chet was doing, he was going to show his gratitude, but in other really substantive ways, like you said. Like, I remember the dinners at their house, at restaurants. I remember the years they gave each of us gifts.
Yeah.
They bought us presents.
Yeah.
You know, it just was there, you know, it was an extension of Chet's heart. And he spent a lifetime trying to figure out how he could extend the love in his heart to everyone around him. And that will be truly one of his legacies. I just know it.
Well, this business, television business, can be filled with a lot of people with a sense of overinflated egos. But with Chet Curtis, what you saw is what you got. And that's why people liked him, because they could identify with him. They said, this is a guy that could be sitting at my kitchen table right now. This is a guy I could have a beer with. This is a guy I could go to a Bruins game with and sit down. And within 30 seconds, I'll feel like I've known him my entire life. And that's why he was so popular and so respected, because he was one of us. Grew up in Amsterdam, New York, but came here, as you said, Susan, and this is, has been his home, and he would consider this his home, I know, because he's a part of the fabric of this community and has been for a long, long time.
Had one of those unique relationships, as you've been talking about, the sincerity that he portrayed that came across the screen. And in fact, I've just been reading a bunch of the comments on our Facebook page, and people are referring to him as Chet. So it's not Mr. Curtis or Chet Curtis, it's Chet. So people felt that really personal relationship. They trusted him that much, and there was that sincerity that they really latched onto. Many people, in fact, I'm reading one woman here, she says, I feel like I've lost a member of my family.